prelude for our service here this morning. We welcome you. The sun is out. Enjoy it while it lasts. It's going to change in the next couple of days, as I understand it. I'm your worship leader, Terry Frank, and it's great to have you here in person or online. We welcome you in the spirit of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. We do have a few announcements. I do want to mention that Pastor Doug Knopp is here to deliver the message this morning, as Pastor Mike is in Philadelphia for another day or two, I believe. And Tom LeBeau is again doing the pastoral care this week. On the schedule for today, we do have the youth adult class meeting at 11 o'clock, along with the elementary group. The elementary group with Kathy Smith and Jan Mescal, and Sandy Muncy is doing our lesson today for the youth and adults. I do want to mention that the order form for the poinsettia plants are in the bulletin, and they will be there, I believe, again next Sunday, but the plants will be put out on December the 7th. You can place your order into the offering plate in the back, and we want the poinsettias to be nice and healthy when they're taken home on December the 24th, which of course is Christmas Eve, and we will be having the Christmas Eve service here at 5 o'clock. Just a reminder. I also want to mention for the calendar for the week, Bible study is 6 p.m. tomorrow night, I believe, and Sandy, she's given me the thumbs up, so we're all good on that. On Wednesday, the prayer gathering will be here at 10:30 a.m., and you're invited to join us either in person or in spirit, wherever you may be. On Thursday at 10:30, the Bible study will be here at the church, and I do want to mention that our first of three practice sessions for the choir for December 17th will be this coming Thursday night, beginning at 7 o'clock here at the church. It is Christ the King Sunday. And with that, I will conclude what I have in the way of announcements. I would like to call upon Karen Christofferson, though. I believe she has something she would like to say.
As you can see, we decorated the church yesterday. If everybody who was here yesterday could stand up so we can thank you for your assistance. And he's not standing up, so it's your fault. And we all want you to participate in finishing decorating. So you will see the tree in the back does not have decorations on that. So as you leave the sanctuary today, please help us in hanging up the Christmas for our tree. Thank you.
Thank you. Pauline.
I would also add that there is a tree in the narthex that we will be using to put hats and mittens on. It's going to be our hat and mitten tree. We have some already that will be put on, and if you have any that you'd like to put out, the tree in the narthex is the one to do it. Also, on the 17th, we will have the ladies' Christmas party, of course, but before that, we will be having a linger longer that will be put on by the Sunday school class, and we welcome you to stay afterwards and enjoy just a little bit of goodies after the church service on the 17th. I didn't put it in here, but it will be in next week to give people the heads up on what's happening the rest of December. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you, Pauline. Are there any other announcements that need to be made? Yes, Sandy. Anything else for the good of the order? Well, seeing none, I will invite you to join me for our call to worship as printed in your bulletin. It's a little bit of reading. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth.
Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It
it is Ye Servants of God, number 181, in your red hymnal, number 181.
Good morning, saints.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, sinners.
Good morning. Good morning.
I wondered if you caught up from the last time I did that. So, just wondering. Good to be with you this day, and I know Mike and Leanne are enjoying time with their family, and it's a blessing for them to do that. So this is the time when we come together in prayer. It is Christ the King Sunday, which is kind of different. It's Christ the King Sunday always comes right after Thanksgiving, but a lot of the time it's also the first Sunday in Advent. This year we have a Sunday in between, which is a breath of fresh air. So Advent starts next week. Don't forget that. Wear purple. Okay? Wear purple. Some of you are doing that today, that's fine. But wear purple next week too. That's the color of the Advent season. So you have in your list of people that in the back of your bulletin need to be lifted up in prayer. We especially want to lift up Arlene, as tomorrow is her surgery day, and she's been anticipating this for a while, and she's ready, right?
Yes.
So we pray that the doctors and nurses will give her the care and direction she needs, and the healing will come fast. And, well, not too fast. We don't want her to hurry back into things, but we pray for her healing. And there are others here that you want to lift up as well, and we will have a time day with thanksgiving for your everlasting care for all of your people, for each one here, and those who are not with us at this moment. You are the greatest ruler of our hearts, and yet we ask for your wisdom for leaders who call people forth on this earth for the good of humankind. Guide those who teach our children. Bless those who feed the poor. Direct those who lead our government. And instill your care in those who make decisions throughout the world. May each have a heart that cares for all people, even as Christ cares for us in his reign with Christian peoples. We praise our ruler this day and always, Christ, our King. Lord, hear us now as we lift up those names of people who are near and dear to us, who need to be strengthened and lifted up in our prayer time.
Cindy.
Francesca.
Maddie.
Barb.
Chip.
For those listed in our bulletin, we especially pray for Arlene and the surgery that she will have tomorrow. Please guide the doctors and nurses who will be providing her for her care and give her strength and healing. Be with all we have mentioned now, Lord. Lift them up before you for your grace, your love, your comfort. Your peace. Hear us now as we pray together. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from
able, would you please stand as we sing hymn number 203 in the red hymnal, Hail to the Lord's Anointed.
Thank you.
we have to work on is, I'm up here where I can hear Martin and the organ very well, but I can't hear any of you. So you need to tune up your volume a little bit next time. Our first scripture is from Ezekiel. God, the Master, says, "From now on, I myself am the shepherd. I'm going looking for them. As shepherds go after their flocks, when they get scattered, I'm going after my sheep. I'll rescue them from all the places they've been scattered to in the storms. I'll bring them back from foreign peoples, gather them from foreign countries, and bring them back to their home country. I'll feed them on the mountains of Israel, along the streams, among their own people. I'll lead them into lush pasture, so they can roam the mountain pastures of Israel, graze at leisure, feed in the rich pastures on the mountains of Israel. And I myself will be the shepherd of my sheep. I myself will make sure they get plenty of rest. I'll go after the lost. I'll collect the strays. I'll doctor the injured. I'll build up the weak ones and oversee the strong ones so they're not exploited. Therefore, God, the Master, says, I myself am stepping in and making things right between the plump sheep and the skinny sheep. Because you forced your way with shoulder and rump and butted at all the weaker animals with your horns till you scattered them all over the hills, I'll come in and save my dear flock. No longer let them be pushed around. I'll step in and set things right between one sheep and another. I'll appoint one shepherd over them all, my servant David. He'll feed them, he'll be their shepherd, and I, God, will be their God. My servant David will be their prince. I, God, have spoken." And from Matthew, the 25th chapter, verses 31 through 46. When he finally arrives, blazing in beauty and all his angels with him, the Son of Man will take his place on his glorious throne. And then all the nations will be arranged before him, and he will sort the people out, much as the shepherd sorts out sheep and goats, putting sheep to his right and goats to his left. And then the king will say to those on his right, "Enter, you who are blessed by my Father. Take what's coming to you in this kingdom. It's been ready for you since the world's foundation. And here's why. I was hungry and you fed me. I was thirsty and you gave me a drink. I was homeless and you gave me a room. I was shivering and you gave me clothes. I was sick and you stopped to visit. I was in prison and you came to me." Then those sheep are going to say, "Master, what are you talking about? When did we ever see you hungry and feed you, thirsty and give you a drink? And when did we ever see you sick or in prison and come to you?" And then the king will say, "I'm telling you the solemn truth. Whenever you did one of these things to someone overlooked or ignored, that was me. You did it to me." Then he will turn to the goats, the ones on his left, and say, "Get out, worthless goats. You're good for nothing but the fires of hell. And why? Because I was hungry and you gave me no meal. I was thirsty and you gave me no drink. I was homeless and you gave me no bed. I was shivering and you gave me no clothes, sick and in prison, and you never visited." Then those goats are going to say, "Master, what are you talking about? When did we ever see you hungry, or thirsty, or homeless, or shivering, or sick, or in prison, and didn't help?" And he will answer them, "I'm telling you the solemn truth. Whenever you fail to do one of these things to someone who was being overlooked or ignored, that was me. You failed to do it to me." And then those goats will be herded into their eternal doom sheep to their eternal reward. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Well, are you still full from your Thanksgiving dinner? Still trying to figure out how to use up the leftovers? I hope you've had a good, happy Thanksgiving. My wife and I had the privilege of being with Bob Evans on Thanksgiving. We took my sister there, and he did a fairly decent job. So we were thankful for that. Speaking of turkeys, did you hear about the turkey who joined the band? Brought his own drumsticks. Yeah, I thought that was pretty bad myself. I'm not Pastor Mike, okay. But I do have a good one for you. My wife was shopping the other day at Walmart and out in the parking lot. When she got back in the car, she found a $20 bill by the car. So she picked it up and got in the car and sat down. And she goes, "Boy, I don't know what to do." So she began to think. She said, "What would Jesus do?" So she turned it into wine. I tell you, our family, with all of our kids, learned that every once in a while you're going to be the subject of a sermon or a joke. We have been journeying through the Gospel of Matthew throughout this past year, and following the lectionary, we've kind of come to the end of Jesus' public ministry. The next section begins the Passion, the Lord's Passion. But today we hear this parable about the final judgment of the world. It's a pretty familiar text. You've heard it many times. And you might ask, why is this text necessary? If God really knows our hearts and knows our minds and our histories better than we know ourselves, why is there a need for this kind of cosmic court drama? Why can't the righteous and the wicked just be sent off to their final destinations without any more thought about it? Perhaps that's because there's a little bit more involved here than just the fate of individuals. We might miss the point of this parable if we hear it simply as information about why some people are going to go to heaven and why some people are going to go to hell. The larger purpose of the judgment is to make it, I think, pretty clear to all of creation the truth about God and the world. The good will be vindicated beyond any possible challenge. The evil will be shown to be evil beyond any excuse. And it will be beyond question that the judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. And the final judgment is proclaimed by the king. Well, who's the king? Well, that's kind of a silly question, isn't it? It's Jesus, Christ the King Sunday. But we don't want to jump to that answer too quickly. The gospel writer does not name the king here, but instead tells us what kind of king he is. We're told where we will encounter this king in distinctly unregal settings among the least of the members of his family, those who have been shoved aside, forgotten, and ignored. In Matthew's picture of the judgment, he is indeed the majestic King of Kings and Lord of Lords that the book of Revelation and the Hallelujah chorus proclaim. And when the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all of the angels with him, and he will sit on the throne of his glory. But that's not how we meet him today. The king turns to those on his right hand, and he speaks of their help to the hungry, those in prison, and others in need, and he says to them, as you did it to the least of these who are members of my family, that was me. You did it to me. He identifies himself with the most humble subjects. Subjects may not be quite the right word precisely, because the king identifies with them. Part of who they are. Those who are in power, you know, they can always play humble for a while. In history, Marie Antoinette and the ladies of her court, they dressed up one time as peasant girls at Versailles, and they pretended to be simple French farm people. While the real peasants often went hungry, the queen could stop her little game anytime she wanted to, and she could go and sit down to a good meal. It's very different with King Jesus. He isn't just dressed up like us. He is one of us. He has come to be one of us in the most difficult times of our lives. The king doesn't just stop with saying that he was with the common people, or some such generality, as true as that might be. Jesus isn't about generalities. He identified with the hungry, the thirsty, the friendless, the poor, the cold, the sick, the imprisoned. That is the way God has been working throughout history, beginning with the liberation of the Hebrew slaves in Egypt. Centuries later, God was among the exiled Jews in Babylon, to whom the prophet Ezekiel spoke in our first lesson. They just heard the news that they had been dreading, that Jerusalem had fallen. Their home, their nation, its rulers, their temple, its priest, the whole political and religious structure that their lives were based on had been destroyed. And they were scattered exiles living in the pleasures of pagan kings. And God says through Ezekiel, I am going to do something about this, and I'm going to do it in person. And using the image of the king as the shepherd, and that was a very common image in the Near East, God says, I myself am going to search for my sheep. I will seek them out. I will rescue them from all the places to which they have been scattered on a day of clouds and thick darkness. I myself, he said, will be the shepherd. What do you know about sheep? Anybody ever raised any? They're pretty stupid animals. And that's why they need a shepherd. We read the 23rd Psalm. It talks about still waters. Sheep won't drink from moving water. It has to be quiet. And they have to be led there by a shepherd. So in Ezekiel, God says, I myself am going to be the shepherd of my sheep. God did not intend to be just a distant overlord. He said, I will set up over them one shepherd. And God in Ezekiel says, that shepherd's going to be my servant David, and he shall feed them He shall be their shepherd. And Ezekiel and his contemporaries may have been puzzled by that, wondering, well, who was really going to be the shepherd? God or God's servant David? Now, as Christians, we can read that passage, and we read it in the light of the resurrection of Jesus that came some 600 years after Ezekiel's time. Jesus is God's servant David, the descendant of David, in whom God is our king. He is the ruler who is the one of us, who's one of us, and who is willing to be identified just like we are, to be with the least of us, and far more than any earthly ruler identified with humble subjects. This is God himself who has entered fully into our life and our death so that we can share in his divine life. The judgment will reveal the sovereignty of Christ for all the world to see, and there will be no doubt about who is the true king of creation. And because that king has entered fully into our world to save it, then our commitment to the king needs to be acted out in this world. A living faith that will show itself in love as we help those in need, as we work for the welfare of the whole of creation, and as we serve him. And the final judgment will make clear what actions have been for the good of God's world and the ones who have been evil. Now, the truth about the king and the truth about the way we should live our lives are basically one and the same. In the earthly ministry of Jesus, we can see exactly the kinds of things for which he commends the righteous in the parable of the judgment. When the crowd that has gathered around him is getting hungry, you remember, some of his disciples said, well, send them away. Let them go into town, go down to Wendy's, get a couple of burgers, come back later. And Jesus says, no, I don't think so. Let's provide food for them. Whenever a sick person or a friend or a relative of a sick person came to Jesus for help, Jesus didn't send them away disappointed. The Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. We are called to pattern our thinking and our behavior after that of Christ. Do not get thrown off by the fact that his provision of food for the multitudes and his healings in the Gospels are described as miracles. You and I aren't called to be wonder workers, but simply to use our own abilities, use the resources that God has given us in following of Christ. Contributing to an organization where people have needs. Bringing in food, clothing for your food pantry and the clothing line that you have out here. Bringing in supplies so that Cheryl can take them to Cuba to help those in need. Volunteering maybe at the hospital sometime. Doing down-to-earth, non-miraculous actions that fit the pattern that Christ has for us. On the other hand, literally, there are those who apparently don't even think about doing such things. Those whom the king addresses as accursed in this story. They're not mass murderers or other spectacular evildoers whose sins hardly need to be emphasized. The cursed ones are people just like us, who do not notice or care about the hungry, the sick, the homeless. Why? Because they're looking out for number one, and they will pass by on the other side. It's one of the changes in our society that troubles me most, that people now only care about the me world. undone those things which we ought to have done. And that is just as serious as the rest of it, which says we have done those things which we ought not to have done. We're reminded to keep our eyes open, to be alert for opportunities to serve. If you're like us, you get more mail for donations than you know what to do with. You have to be careful about some of those. Some of those, if you donate a dollar, 80 cents of that dollar goes for the administration. That's why I'm a big pusher of UMCOR, United Methodist Committee on Relief. If you give a dollar for the United Methodist Committee on Relief, that whole dollar goes for the relief. The administration costs are covered by our fair share given to the conference and the denomination. Find some place that you know the money is going to go and help people. We know that some are scams, but C.S. Lewis noted in one of his books that in this parable, those who are ignored people in need are consigned to a place not meant for human beings at all. The eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. And Cain's, remember Cain's response to God? Am I my brother's keeper? Well, that might become one of the slogans of hell. Am I my brother's keeper? It can serve as a warning to us, just as the hope of the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world can encourage us. The reason for us to care for others is not just so that we can get into heaven. Christ came from heaven to serve us, and we are invited to faithfully, in accord with the truth that God's judgment reveals to us about God and the world, to join that service. It's Christ the King Sunday. He doesn't wear a regal robe and a crown filled with jewels. He serves those in need. Pray with me. Lord God, we want to be your humble servant people, practicing and doing what the King of Kings has showed us by his own examples to do amongst your people. Help us to find ways to serve those in need that will shed the light of your radiance upon them. In Jesus' name. Amen. So I hope Thursday when you gather together with family and friends, or Bob Evans or whoever, that you took a moment to reflect on the many things you are thankful for, the many gifts that have been a blessing in your life, the offerings that you share with your church. Some stay here for the ministries of the church. Some go to the conference for the ministries of the conference. Some go to Cuba to touch the lives of people. But we're a blessed people. We really are a blessed people. And you can never, 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 never outgive God. It's not possible. So as you share your offerings today, and then every Sunday, whenever you are here, whatever gifts you share in response to what God has given to you, you're blessed. So let's pray over our offerings. gift we have received, including the gift of faith, we give you thanks. For every gift we can give you, we give thanks. Not as we ought, but as we are able, O God, we return. Grant us faith and confidence in things both large and small, and open our hearts to what it means to be generous. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you please stand and join with me in the
Spirit directs. May your love, mercy, and peace.